everyone. This is your host, Yoshino, and you are listening to episode number 68 of Artists Decoded. In this episode, I get the opportunity with Justin Hopkins to interview Rebecca Farr, who is a painter based in Los Angeles. And I think we had a really great discussion with her. What'd you think, man?
Well, I think it's important to say that this was our first live podcast in the No Wave space. So I think for the first half of the conversation, I was still getting out my nervous jitters with the questions. But after we kind of fell into the kind of groove of everything, I think we got into some really good territory where she was explaining her spiritual background and her religious upbringing and how that played into her most recent series. And I got a lot out of the conversation personally.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I think it's good to experiment. And, you know, we were able to do this first live podcast, which we want to do a lot of live podcasts in Los Angeles. I also want to announce that No Wave is offering limited edition time release prints. If you go to www.nohwave.co/shop, you can go get prints from Daniel Seagrove, Emilio Villalba, and Steve Kim. We're offering a discount code through Artist Decoded. You have to type in Artist Decoded at checkout for 10% off. The sale is over on April 17th, so make sure to get your prints before then. All right, so here is the episode with Rebecca Farr for Artist Decoded, episode number 68. You ready? Yeah, I'm ready.
Good.
Cool.
Thanks for coming, everybody. So sweet.
Yeah, thanks for coming, everyone. This is an experiment. This is a live version of Artist Decoded, the podcast, by Justin Hopkins.
By me?
By Justin
no,
Hopkins.
No, 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 no.
Artist Decoded by Justin Hopkins.
Oh, geez, Louise.
And yeah, we're here with Rebecca Farr, artist extraordinaire. And I don't know, tell us a little bit about yourself.
I'm happy to be here with you guys. Thank you. I am a Los Angeles-based artist, and I was born in L.A., but at two, my family moved up to the Northwest, and I first was in Central Oregon, and then Seattle. Went to school at Evergreen, which is known as a hippie school, and meandered back towards L.A., after years of living in the Northwest, some in Mexico.
What was it like living in Mexico?
It was fabulous. I left when I was 28, and I thought I was going for a two-month trip with a friend. And I didn't make very many plans in Mexico, and I also knew that I was doing something weird because I let my house go. My car broke down, and instead of getting a new car, I saved money, and I biked for 6 months in Seattle in the rain for work. I really was untethering myself. I quit my job. So when I arrived in Mexico, I definitely had a feeling like, take me. As wherever this needs to go, I'm going. And we were in the Houston airport, and the person I was going to be traveling with lost her passport and completely derailed that she couldn't go. So then now I'm arriving in Mexico at 11:30 at night, don't really speak Spanish, and had no sense of what I was doing. And I was ecstatic to have this kind of, it's exactly what I was calling for.
Why do you think you were calling for that at that particular time in your life?
Dare I say a hippie thing and say Saturn return, but I definitely was at a moment of, just it was time to get serious about what was essentially my focus. And I had been doing sexuality education and advocacy for various communities for about 8 years, and it was starting to feel like a real career, and that scared me because it was derailing my art. And I kind of put a stake in the ground and said, I'm going to let go of everything so that I can really land as an artist.
Was so from the beginning, were you always trying to seek out being an artist? Were you trying to, you know, I guess, make a career out of being an artist?
No, in fact, very slow to move towards commercial art. Growing up, my grandmother was a really good artist, and my father had an ambivalent relationship with watching her life as an artist. And when I then emerged and was like drawing all the time, there was kind of this message like, don't do that, it's dangerous, because she was bipolar and there was alcoholism in the family and a lot of drug use. And so he had really merged that the practice of making art was connected to great suffering, and kind of said, it's okay as a hobby, but don't get hooked on this stuff. And when I was going to Evergreen, I thought I was going to be a marine biologist. And so I started with all these science classes, but it was because it's such a good school. They did this core program. So you were speaking Spanish and doing, studying flora and fauna of Mexico, but then also doing these biological studies of the sea there, but then also looking at the history of oil and looking at literature. So it was a very core program. And thank God for liberal arts education, because I had the sense I was this major scientist. And all I did that first year that I was there was draw. It just, as I moved into this literature and was infused with all these angles that I wasn't expecting in the education, it just gurgled up. And by the end of that year, my dorm room, which I was lucky enough to have my own room, because poor roommate if they were my roommate, was just portraits and roof, ceiling to floor, was just portraits and drawing and drawing and drawing and drawing and drawing. And anytime I wasn't in class, any Friday night hanging out, I just want to get stoned and draw. And
mostly get stoned.
I wasn't Evergreen. And drugs actually were a part of awakening art for me. I don't do it now so much, but it really was this huge portal. And I think particularly because there was this rock over my cave that I couldn't access this without it feeling like I was breaking taboo or betrayal in the family, some sense it was a very dangerous hobby. Somehow.
Was your gateway for drawing through like biology, studying like the sketchbooks and things they have to do to kind of catalog from life?
I think there was some, but honestly, I think my attraction to marine biology was one, the ocean, mm-hmm. Just pure and simple, the raw power and beauty and amazingness of it. And right. But I think there was like this image of myself, and in it, I was on some like, you know, floating boat in the middle of some brave sea, and all these dudes and me, and I had a thick braid, and I threw it across as I like dove into the sea. But the real feeling was like discovering some amazing animal deep, deep, deep in the darkest places that nobody knows about, and resurrecting it into the light. And I think on a Jungian level, mythic level, I'm 100% on my course I was right when I was 10 and I thought that seems really cool. It's more of a psychological and a creative process than it is practical. Right. And when I was at Evergreen, we immediately were following biologists around, and I remember we were on this field study in Eastern Oregon, and the biologists were talking about rerouting the river, and it was such a sorrowful project because there'd been all this destabilization with the cattle and all these layers of history of kind of breaking the relationship with the soil and cultivating it and trying to figure out how to heal it. Mm-hmm. And I could see they didn't know. And something in that made me break my vow to biology. Like, and I saw, you're not that happy. Like, you're studying the worst thing. Like, you're not getting to study life. You're studying this despair. And I was like, I don't think that's where I want to go.
So, how old were you? Do you remember?
I went to college. That was my friend right at the beginning of the year. And I took a year off. So I was 18. Because I was a young kid. Yeah, so 18.
Yeah. And then did you, so from there, after you made that realization for yourself, did you really start diving into studying art or studying how to paint?
Well, it was interesting because that summer, I still was thinking I was going to be a marine biologist, but I had been doing a good amount of drugs, hallucinogenics, and really loved mystical states and transcendental experiences, and was planning that summer to go to Tassajara, which is a Zen temple in outside of San Francisco, and had all the plans lined up and everything, and then it got derailed, and my parents were like, you know, you need to work. Come to Whidbey Island, be a waitress, and I just unraveled. And thank God I didn't go to a Zen center, because there's this idea, I think, if you're like feeling kind of fragile or there's a psychological breakthrough to be had, go to a Zen center. And that is the last place you want to go if you're feeling like you need therapeutic support. It's actually quite challenging on a psyche, that culture. Hmm. And I think most Zen centers would agree with me. But so I basically stopped school for 9 months, moved to a small town, and sorted out, like, what is this art thing? Why do I want to do it? Is it okay? Like, is this dangerous in a way?
Yeah. Did you discover that while you're using psychedelics as well? Or did you kind of go cold turkey and not?
I went uber cold turkey because I had an acid trip where I was all by myself and I'd climbed up into a tree. And I heard, this needs to be your last trip. You have had wonderful opportunities and growth, and you officially are using this drug now. It's not curious. You're not learning new things. You need to go do this on your own.
Did you climb up the tree first?
No.
Or did you?
After.
Or was that a decision that you made while you were on acid?
It sure was.
Yeah. Okay.
And I really had a lot of faith and trust in myself in the hallucinogenic realm. And I really also trusted that voice that, and I knew it was true. Like, I wasn't innocent anymore in it. I wasn't exploring it with great wonder and curiosity. I was kind of like, okay, now it'll start turning that. Like, I knew too much about it. And I also knew that I was really hungry for something that actually wasn't in that drug. And that what the states that I was experiencing on that drug were completely available to us without the drug.
Was it the sense of exploration or just some kind of inspiration that you didn't have in your regular waking state?
It was a sense of this is always so tricky when you talk about spirituality because it has such cliche words, and they're really the best words sometimes. Like, I would say it was a union.
Okay.
That I felt a complete connection with a spiritual sense of being embodied and being here. I mean, it was just pure delight for me. Mm. I mean, it was fun, but it was also had this level of kind of a wordless feeling of being connected.
And we spoke briefly before when we first met that you had gone through a pretty religious upbringing. This was right after?
Not fiercely religious. It was, my mother was Catholic, and that was very thinly expressed. I did go to a catechism once, but my father, it wasn't that we went through a temple. He was Zen Buddhist. We didn't practice with the community, but the philosophy and the engagement with him was very strong. So in that way, yes. But it was kind of a church of one.
I see.
I was the disciple. But when I was six, he would read Taoist tales for my child, you know, my bedtime story. And there was all these kind of koan discussions starting incredibly young. And this engagement with this idea about enlightenment that pervaded. And I have to say, because I think I very to the bone of me authentically have a very mythically driven mind, I just totally took it on. Loved it.
So is that what you were seeking when you did the hallucinogenics up the tree?
Enlightenment?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
In the end, I mean, mm-hmm. I think it was, I want to wake up. And my imagery from with my father was interesting because he wasn't really invested in a community that was practicing that regularly. So it was kind of his own hybrid experience. And that included what I would call now is almost like an Old Testament foundation.
Hmm.
Some of that, I think, being a white man, a white guy from La Jolla, California,
yeah.
Taking on Zen Buddhism without really having teachers to direct that there's an appropriative nature to entering these streams of religious practice, which I think are tricky. And without consciousness of that, it's like a lot of fire and brimstone
right.
narrative kind of entered in. So we had a very specific kind of landscape of what that was that I as I then entered into a Zen practice of my own with a teacher and a community that really got edited.
What does spirituality mean to you now?
I think that's a really good question. The first word that comes to my mind is practice, like a practice. And in that, I think it's a repeated commitment, conversation, just like in painting or it's a ritual of returning to this kind of space. And for me, that has a lot to do with meditation. But I don't have a sense of it being a specific definable thing.
Mm. Yeah.
But I would say it's a practice. It's a daily practice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it means so many things, I think, to so many people. And I think, at least for me, spirituality is a singular thing in terms of me understanding what that means for myself.
Mm-hmm.
And creating those practices, whatever it is, for myself. And also meditation, at least, you know, the way that I view it is when I'm just completely focused in some sort of area, it's like a meditation.
Yeah.
You know? What do you think meditation is? Like, how would you define?
Well, it's gone through a lot of incarnations for me. When I started meditating, I was about 14 when I got real serious about it with my dad, and we were doing Aikido. And the three teachers that we had were these kind of rogue renegades that had broken from their lineage, so they were a little wild. And we never knew how long our classes were going to take, and they wanted you to not know. And so sometimes you were there for an hour, and they'd offer you cake. And then the next time you were there for 3 hours, and you're working with live blades. And like,
what?
And
are these real instructors? This sounds like a scam of some kind.
No. Yeah. And we met 3 days a week for 1 to 5 hours, and you didn't know. And you might have homework and class in the morning, and you were just, I was so into it. And it was this amazing thing to be practicing with my dad. So meditation at that time was very tough. If I had pain, I wasn't going to get up. It was this kind of rage against the body a little bit for me. And my imagery and my kind of fantasy about what awakening would be would literally, like, this little fire would shoot out of my head, and then this, like, body would crumble onto the floor. And
whoa.
It was incredibly
some kind of rapturous experience.
Old Testament.
Yeah.
Cloaked around this kind of much more cool or comfortable imagery for me of Buddha.
Mm-hmm.
And then as I moved, it's almost like I had to do a chin up for as long as I could. And I was like shaking and not going to give up this really macho vision of it. And I just bit till my teeth touch, and I realized this is a corrupt imagery. I mean,
right.
I surrendered. But that took a long time because when I came back to school, after my little breakthrough that, yes, I was an artist and I dropped all the science stuff and went for art when I came back to Evergreen. And I was clean as a whistle. There were no hallucinogens or pot or anything. And I, the very second day I was on campus, I met my Zen teacher, Ado Frances Carney, and studied with her for like 10 years at the Olympia Zen Center overall. And I still had those nuggets of this kind of rugged, you know, I will sit, my legs can be screaming and I'm going to push through it. And there were great merit to that.
Yeah, like just the building of the discipline and focus.
I really built discipline. And I've got two states that were just so wonderful. And I had such an amazing sangha and such an amazing practice with my teacher. And one of the most intimate, and, you know, people can get real confused about a monastic life. To me, oh, God, I think it's the most unbelievably sensual, passionate, sexy existence.
Yeah, I mean, that is pretty different than how I interpret it, yeah.
And it's also brutally hard, and you're devastated sometimes, and you're humiliated, and things are exposed that you want hidden.
You got to explain the sexiness of the monastic lifestyle, because I don't see it.
I just find, I mean, this is the turning point of how meditation shifted for me, because for so long, my practice was kind of like to rip through the body. It was very masculine. This was not to be honored or taken care of. But in the process of going at it in that way, you know, sitting for 6 hours, you're going to start having some of those magical hallucinatory experiences that I really love that were up in the tree earlier. And a flock of birds would come, you know, geese would go through, and they would go through your whole body. And, I mean, that is like you are in that eros of existence.
So you were able to get to those states similar as taking the hallucinogenics simply
100%.
After how long, do you think?
It vary. I mean, sometimes you'd go sit down and in 30 minutes you're having some event. I mean, there's a practice that about at a 40-minute practice is really nice, because there's something that does seem to happen in that last 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. I've found that.
For mindfulness meditation or different form?
Yeah, in like a Zen practice.
Okay.
And in that, we didn't really have any specific breath work or counting or sensing of body. It's incredibly simple. It's just posture and breath. Mm-hmm. But I also think, you know, you could be at a session for 4 days and just be having the shittiest time on earth. And you may have practiced for 15 years and you don't know what your next meditation's going to have for you. So it could be at any moment that you hear something, or, you know, like there could be a beautiful moment where you're actually sitting next to somebody who's wiggling a lot, and at first it bugs you, and then all of a sudden your heart cracks open and you feel their suffering, and all you do is love them. You couldn't love them more. Like, those kind of moments happen a lot. But I kind of fell through Zen too, because I had been there 10 years-ish and had left for a bit and came back. And I was sitting on the cushion and I heard over and over and over, am I good? Am I good? Like, that was my thought. And I just thought, are you kidding? I've been here for 10 years practicing ignorance, and that I already am this thing that we're seeking. How can I be obsessed with morally being good?
That's what you mean? Being morally good, like a good person?
Yeah. And I was so furious that I was still asking that, because I actually had like intellectually worked that out. And I realized this is Christian. Even though I don't identify necessarily as a Christian,
you mean those were Christian thoughts?
And my lineage,
the morals,
was. And my dad's training with me and the whole Old Testament stuff. So in that, I just was like, you've got to work this out. So that it isn't this appropriated language. And there's kind of this pushing away of this thing that I'm actually kind of ashamed of. And so I started working more with that shame and took a break from meditation and let go of the Zen Center. I just floated for about 5 years. I moved to LA. Lisa and I got together and just lived and let myself be nothing special, nothing important going on with that. It wasn't giving me any data for like valuableness.
When do you find yourself being the most happy with the art that you create? Is it when you let yourself freely express and go, or when you're going through some painful struggle?
Yeah, all this whole time with this process, art's been happening. And I feel like, God, there's so many different kinds of happiness inside a painting. That there is such elation to start a new painting. I never feel choked up by a white canvas. I'm ravenous to get at it. And I love the first marks. Oftentimes I think they're my best, and then I destroy them, and then I spend the whole 90% of the painting trying to get them back. I don't want to admit how often that is that I feel that probably the beginning is my most favorite, and then the very end. It's like a snake that bites its tail.
Because then it all starts to come together.
Yeah.
But the process.
You can tell there's not enough energy in the painting. So it might be the most beautiful marks, but you can't. For me, I don't feel, and maybe this will change. Maybe I'm going to do like one brush painting soon. But I definitely.
A very large brush or a very small canvas.
Yeah. I really like the struggle to be in there and to feel the effort. So I never have mercy on that. Joy at the beginning of a painting. And but then even in the struggle, there's most days I feel super frustrated and super ecstatic. And sometimes bored, and sometimes, you know, everything.
You can go on.
I'm curious about you go and you say your first marks are your favorite. Do you go in with a plan then, or do you just kind of improvise?
It varies. Right now, I'm doing, I think I am definitely a method painter, and that I'm one that will evolve and find it in a process. I don't come at it executing.
You're not trying to get to a specific end point?
Mm-mm. And in fact, all of these paintings have like 5-6 compositions underneath them, and they'll just smush and mush and change and evolve. But all of these have under drawings from the disasters of war, from Goya.
Okay.
And that was almost like I love his brilliance with compositions and the way he uses the cross or the X and the way he light and dark weights. I just think he's brilliant. And I also love the content, because much of this work is about my father passing and about this conflict that we had about the nature of suffering. Because in the end, he was still very much like, get up and out of here, wake up. The toil of the human dilemma, you have a right to get out of it, but he wasn't very merciful even of his own. And I moved deeply away from that. And so my practice now is very feminine. I practice from a lot of different traditions, but Christian mythology is definitely a part of it now. And I practice Shaktipat, which is a great mother tradition, with Uma at the Oakwood House. She's amazing in Venice. And it's evolved into a place where I feel in love with the body in this spiritual state, and kind of a healing with my relationship with suffering. So I wanted to use those drawings to initiate these, because they feel like a prayer or like a point to say, we begin this story in gazing into the face of suffering. And then from there, they kind of moved into these kind of baptismal washings and healings, and for my dad to let him go and for me to kind of come more into the body and into the presence.
I'm not going to lie. Those people back there kind of threw me off.
Knocking on the window.
What the heck are these guys doing? I did have a question, but then I lost it.
Well, I'm just looking at the paintings and trying to put myself in what you're saying. Because to me, there's like, yeah, there's very like, at least the obvious like people in water, like at least partially submerged, mm-hmm. either emerging or submerging. Mm-hmm. But like, how are the, like, is there anything in particular about these compositions that you gotten? Are these, do they come from references? Are they purely emotive from memories of whatever it is you experienced with your father, or, mm-hmm. or how did these become these, like what we're looking at?
Yeah. Through Mushin and Gushin.
Just Mushin and Gushin. Yeah. So you don't go into it with like, you have like memories or photos or anything. You just go.
I studied with a Russian painter for how many years? 4 years? Mm-hmm. After Evergreen, I came back after living in Mexico to live at the Zen temple for a second round. And I was getting real serious about the practice. Then I was going to be a monk and the whole thing. And just by chance in Olympia, there was this amazing Russian painter, Simon Kogan. And there were 8 students, and we met with him. I have a thing for 3 times a week. And we did painting and drawing and traveled to, but he was very traditional sculptor and painter. So he taught me a really rigid, hard-earned dynamic anatomy. So I have a real trust in my hand to be able to play with the figure. And it also, I love it. And it will come up in automatic drawings really easily, and it will emerge. So it's very hard for me not to find bodies and things.
Okay. So this is all just impulsive kind of.
So then improvised the drawing of Goya would be an initiation. Mm-hmm. And even in these, I can see how Goya's drawings are underneath them, although it's impossible to see that
for
everybody else. And then it would just keep evolving and changing and move until they settled.
Mm-hmm. And you just decide when it feels right, then they're finished?
Yeah.
Okay.
How do you know when they're finished?
It just feels right, man.
Feels right, man.
What does it feel like? What does it look like?
Mercy.
Like mercy?
It does feel like mercy.
What does that mean?
Because these ones in particular had so much fight in them. And they felt, that one there, the single figure, is the only one that feels like a portrait of my father. And all the others really are self-portraits, even though there's 2 figures. And it's almost like these parts of myself that had been separated out, spirit and body, or these dual aspects reconnecting. So when they would evolve and evolve and evolve, and there truly is just a sense of the sponge is full, there's nothing left to do.
And you don't just do paintings. Why do you decide for a certain series, for whatever you're feeling, to go into the painting realm versus what you were doing sculpturally or mm-hmm. casting? Or it looked like there was some element of collage mm-hmm. on the work that I saw on your mm-hmm. On your website. Are you just constantly changing and shifting, or do you have these certain ideas that like, oh, I'm going to save that for this for painting, or is it just all instinctive?
I was super like religiously traditional figurative painter and for really long time. And the first shift was collage. And that came, again, looking at more at this lineage around Christianity and my discomforts and of it. And it was a manifest destiny and looking at kind of these mythic motifs. I broke it into 4 that drove and organized the movement west. And so I took collaged books that I was destroying and ripped them up and had rules for myself that I couldn't duplicate or manipulate. The imagery, it had to come straight from these books that I was, you know, and they were like coffee table books for a buck at the last bookstore or whatever. Like no books clearly that were in the nobody cares about them anymore.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Category. And I was using them first as a study because I thought this will be a reference for painting.
So why the rules then? Just as a challenge?
Yeah. And I also think it gave me a feeling of it was following this feeling of using resources in kind of callous and brutal ways, which I was kind of exploring, this breaking, the practice of cultivation being actually a practice of breaking. Identity for indigenous people, timber, the way we industrialized and moved west, and that was my lineage. So it was like,
do you think there's I apologize.
Oh, sorry. And then it was connected to Christ and this practice of that. So I was just working that stuff out.
Gotcha. Did you think there was a violence in the cutting of it at all?
Yes.
Was that on purpose?
It felt rabid. I mean, first of all, it gets really uncomfortable because your fingers are all sticky and there's all this stuff and you're moving so fast. And I had a feeling of being a feral animal a lot in painting those. And I moved in and out with acrylic paint. And it's something in it just unhooked painting for me in general, that it could be that. Mm-hmm. It was great. And the sculpture also is a new element that when I was doing meditation around these paintings, these white forms kept coming in my mind, and they were like these folding, enveloping body space. And so basically I was like, I think I need to make that again. It'll be a reference for painting. Mm-hmm. And when I figured out cheesecloths with this plasters are the right shape and the right, they became their own animal. And in fact, they derailed the show I thought I was going to be making and became stronger to direct the work.
So it's like a painting is from the context of which these things come out 100%. Of, and then that shifts the focus.
Yeah.
I see.
Now it feels like those sculptures have sprung loose a lot of imagination around installation and sculpture. So I feel like that's on the move, on its own now. It feels like it's been born and is like a toddler figuring out how to walk a little bit on its own.
That's exciting.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it seems like you're really in tune with your feeling. And how, because again, like, I mean, I'm not a painter, you know, but I am a visual artist. And I think you have to be really in tune and in touch with yourself to be able to draw figure out of paint just from the mind. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like that's counter to the way that when you were teaching or when you were studying under that Russian professor, it seems counter to that. Is there a reason for that? Or
I think that was just training, and thank God for it, because I think it's actually hard to get these days. Like, I'm so grateful. I mean, he was grumpy at me a lot and yelled at us all the time, but he's very loving too.
Yeah. But it seems like that was extremely structured.
Yeah. It was kind of like going to the military. Mm-mm. You had to work hard, and he expected you to work throughout the week, and it was rigorous.
Yeah. There seems like there's a through line of struggle with your training.
I love discipline and struggle, and I really love, God.
Love that too, actually. I like to struggle through a lot of things.
Is it the feeling of overcoming that you like, or is it the feeling of the actual suffering itself that you like?
I think it's not that I'm crazy with like, ooh, I want this to hurt really bad today in meditation. It's possibly that I don't trust if something doesn't hurt a little bit. Like I would say, even as I'm listening to myself, I'm like, check that out. Maybe you can drop that one off on the curb. This whole like, it has to hurt before I can conclude the painting.
Well, that seems like a Christian thing too.
I agree. And I think it's connected to these deep archetypes that although I didn't grow up going to church except for on Christmas Eve, it's undeniable. And it's taken me a long time to allow that to come through. And now in my meditations, because I had so many years of tending to building the archetype and the language of Buddha. And now I just find Christ and imagery of that is there all the time. And I used to push it away and get squeamish, and it couldn't be, you know, just really suffering under that. But yes, I think the idea of the cross has become something very different for me than, and even as I say it, I'm like a little, like it's just, I don't identify specifically as religious, but I am in love with the archetypes that are mm-hmm. present in that.
What about it, do you think?
About?
Well, you said the cross and I would imagine the archetype of Jesus has changed. It sounds like you are still uncomfortable with admitting that you're drawn to those things. But why?
Well, like with the cross in itself, I think, you know, I've looked at this and I'm like, God, it's so physical. Or like the movie The Passion, where they're like having lipids fly off of his arm as they're whipping. Yeah. You know, it's like this kind of obsessive, shameful, violent patriarchy that's destroyed the world in the name of this. And that truly grieves me that it is the lineage I come from is this way. And at the same time, that concept of the cross in this show, it really came to me that that's exactly what I was painting, was this commitment to say, I will stay in this body, just like Buddha did under the tree, actually, and I will bear it, and I will stay with it with mercy and an open heart. And it, you know, the cross is kind of this vertical pulse that is the cosmos, and then this horizontal plane, which is the embodiment. And right in that center is energetically like the heart chakra, or that place where those two places are touching. I believe awakening is there. And I think it has something to do with saying, yes, I'll stay. I'll be in it. Mm. I'm not going to squirm. I'm not going to run away from it, even if I can. I think that's what I'm attracted to. And I, up to this point, have seen the markers or the breadcrumbs connected to suffering, but it's changing. It's on the move for me. And I don't think it has to be as hard. I hope it doesn't.
Yeah. That seems interesting to me. Cause like a Buddhism, I feel like there's this, wanting to decrease the amount of suffering.
Right.
And Christianity, like suffering is inherently in the voyage of everything. It's like you right. can't escape it.
Right.
So there's like a full submission to the idea that there's a certain amount of suffering that will happen internally and externally.
Right.
Which is what kind of like the Christ journey is, kind of like where you are inspiring and then brutally murdered because of that. And you right. are forced to allow it to happen, even though you know it's going to happen.
Right.
And same with the followers, right? It's a kind of submitting to your flaws or whatever.
Right.
And people kind of take that into like a really brutal territory. But just like the base kind of broad strokes.
Right.
It's one of, at least the way I grew up, which is my mom was this Unitarian Buddhist kind of woman. My dad was hyper Christian.
Oh, so we have a little thing in common.
I was waiting. I want to keep it fresh. But yeah, so they're at odds with each other, but they were, you know, they have been married for over 30 years and continue to be married, because yeah. there's a definite Venn diagram where the center is that at least if they are to go to their, you know, respective philosophies to the fullest, it is one of I guess turning the other cheek, or at least being okay with, or at least you would hope that they'd be okay with like suffering together. And I actually am not sure where I'm going with this, but there's some connection yeah. there.
Well, it seems like there's a balance there too, because mm-hmm. if one is of suffering, the other one is of not suffering, you know.
We're trying to be detached from suffering.
Detached. It's
like there's two philosophies of it, yeah.
They're both saying all life is suffering is mm-hmm. one of the first things mm. to understand of Buddhism. But I think it's saying this is a choice.
Right.
You if you were in the right place, in the right mindset, you would wake up and see it's perfect. And I think that is true. And I think you can unravel Christ and find the same message.
Yeah.
The pathway, it's not they're really saying anything that different in my experience, and I'm super humble to say I know so little specifically about like a Christian practice because I've never had one. Except for up in here. But I feel like it's just exactly like the position that you take on suffering. And is it something you can end by almost like by waking up in this present moment or surrendering in this present moment? Mm-hmm. And with Christ, I feel like he's saying, I surrender. I yield to spirit in this. And in Buddhism, it feels like Buddha said, I'm not leaving finger on the ground until I wake up. And that it is about an ignorance of like, I've been confused. Mm-hmm. There's a truth that is running through me at all times. And I forgot in a way. Mm. Do you see it different?
No, I don't see it different. I'm just also trying to see the connection to the those two opposing philosophies on suffering in the work here.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking about it, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah, well, it feels to me like what came through was almost a washing and an individuating from my dad. Allowing it to be different. So in many ways, I'm an uncharted territory to a lot of your questions because mm-hmm. it does feel like some old things that no matter how conscious or hardworking I was in figuring it out with his passing, it's like some karmic tie around him. And I do feel set free and untethered inside of that mythic soup.
Mm.
And I can tell I'm swimming towards softer waters, more feminine. My practices have become very gentle. If my leg hurts, I'm moving. and I know I don't need to sit there and feel like it might fall off anymore. And I don't feel drawn to that kind of testing or my rituals don't feel violent.
Is that what you think? Is that what you consider to be the masculine side of things? Is kind of like bullheadishness?
It was for me. It yeah. was a denial of kind of a feminine. It was a rising up and getting out rather than landing in. And I think that's much more my interest is almost like an embodiment rather than a let's wake up and get out of here. It's like I don't know what it is, but. I'm here, so I want to really be here. And I think those words are tricky, masculine and feminine. That
I agree, yeah.
Yeah, I don't mean to pin that on men or to say, you know, because the words are just so tricky because inside the feminine is also shadowy things and light things. And so mm-hmm. I say that with like a giant asterisk or something.
No, it's interesting to me because when people say that, I'm always confused by it too. Because when people think of feminine, they think of like gentle nurturing, and when they think of men or masculine, it's like aggression and testosterone, and which it is. And
right.
Same with the, I think they have these archetypes because they are pretty common.
Right.
But I was just wondering what you meant as far because your work to me seems still. Although it feels serene, it still feels very aggressive to me.
Yeah.
Just with how like viscerally the paint
process,
is handled.
Right.
Yeah. It feels
yeah.
pretty 100%. Masculine still, just yeah. to me. So.
Yep. And I'm queer. So I think there's definitely, I don't identify as just woman. And I feel a sense of fluid gender in that. And I think that's also the two. I think that's a good thing to pull up in this conversation because I do think that it's actually if anything, these paintings are the search or this to get to the darker, mushier place that doesn't have a word that could describe male or female in that. Some kind of new integration. of all that. Because, you know, there's also the fiery feminine and the very, you know, it's not necessarily about genitalia.
Sure. Yeah.
But it's just the language we have around dualities that get tricky. And I think I spent a lot of time, male or female, on the side of conquering something. And I think it's shifted. This body of work is very much talking about that shifting.
What do you think you conquered by after creating these pieces?
Oof. I think I was able to go through a grief process with my dad's death that is so lucky. Like, I think it's really hard to digest those kinds of things in normal, especially, I don't know, other cultures, but it certainly feels like we have like death light, you know, like you get some flowers and da da da. And well, he was 70, that's fine. But he was such a huge character in my psyche. And I think I conquered that, like the ability to truly say goodbye and to digest all those layers of complicated emotion between us and have an open palate. That it isn't quite as defined or organized as it was before.
Yeah. That's an accomplishment.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a lot of people allow themselves to be that honest with themselves and to allow themselves to have that grieving process. Mm-hmm. And maybe some people just don't know how to express it, mm-hmm. or know how to channel it. We're doing the best that we can, yeah. too.
Grief is a weird river. Grief is weird.
Yeah.
I think that could be a bumper sticker.
Grief is a weird river?
Grief is just, I mean, it feels like this like oily, dark river, but it is so strange. You cannot wrap, it defies your logic and how it moves and when it comes and how, I mean, we're still working it out. It is definitely unraveling huge things for me to go through this process with him. And I do think that we are urged to tidy it up before we should. Mm-hmm. And I think artists have an opportunity, you know, like, God, it's just so critical. We have artists to point towards these things and get to process these things and create our own funerals that last 9 months, you know. Mm-hmm.
Do you think when you're painting something like this that it's a therapeutic meditation in itself, because you have to be so aware of everything you're pushing, all the paint you're mushing around and things mm-hmm. like that? And is it a meditative process for you, or is there ever a time where you just feel, because they're for a show, like they were for a gallery show, did you ever feel that you had to push through these things to get to like a economic ends? Does that make any sense? Is there any like
I did
friction?
I mean, part of it is they came late because the sculptures dominated, and then as I was going, it was like there's new paintings that need to be made that are in reference to the content that's coming from the sculpture. So there was definitely a time pressure.
Does that ever get in the way of fully express, like being in the moment with these paintings?
I think they're part. I mean, I think I like pressure.
Right.
And I think I work well with it. I definitely had some dark nights where I thought, oh, and I'm not finding this. This isn't working, you know, da, da, da. But I also have a tendency to be really prolific and overproduce for shows.
I see.
So I know my nature that I will not stop until it is right and I can believe in it and stand for it. So I didn't feel driven I didn't feel driven by the market to make these works by any stretch. And I felt like I was allowed the real do. And then I wasn't in charge. I definitely felt like I was surrendering to like, I have to find you rather than tell you what you are. But I do think they're a meditative process. And oftentimes, like that sweet spot of making something where you're like, oh my God, that's happening, it's happening. And the minute you start saying that, you should brush down, because this is so good is like the worst thing to say to yourself.
You just like that struggle. There's that struggle again.
Well, yes, but it also, there is some place where I feel like not knowing what you're doing and being really present at the same time is where good work lives. And that it's a radio dial that comes in and out how much I'm hanging there. The more you do it, the more you're there. But I also think you have to have those moments where your critical thinking is happening and your judgment and assessment. And so it's like a balance between that, like a conversation between that meditative state and then assessment and being brutal and being like, this is failing, or this doesn't work, or only this one part. You have to have those moments, or I don't think you'll execute good work. Mm. I won't.
I concur.
Oh, good.
Well,
I'm looking at you because I feel like I accidentally dominated the back end of that conversation.
No, I'm listening. Yeah, I mean, I guess we can, should we stop there, or do you have any more questions?
I mean, I have a lot more questions, but I think that get really boring for a podcast setting. They would. I mean, I want to ask, I'll ask off mic about the painting and process a little bit more.
Okay.
Yeah, we appreciate all your time.
Oh,
thank you.
It's such an honor to be asked here. Thank you so much. Yeah. It's a really, really unique, line of questions.
Oh, good.
Pathway. It's really interesting to be here. It's really been fun. Thank you.
Cool.
Yeah, thanks for coming. We appreciate you taking the time to do this.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. All right.
Cool.
Weird about live podcasts. It's like extra awkward.